Yeah, I think we'll let the others come in when they feel like coming up. So just to introduce Amelia, Amelia used to be a member of the European Parliament. Parliament as in Parliament, she doesn't look like an MP, but she was. She was the youngest MP ever, so far. Also representing the Pirate Party, which is actually called the Pirate Party. It's not a joke. The Pirate Party is a political movement that is over about 15 years old now. It's been building up over time and essentially represents an very unique internet-centric set of values around how politics should work. The Pirate Party is also one most majority seat in rather the largest share of seats in the Icelandic Parliament, and now they've been invited to form the government there. But in Europe, in the European Union, every country has its own parliament, and there's a European Parliament which represents all the countries. And so Amelia was in the European Parliament. She's here in Bangalore for about a month.
So thank you for this very kind introduction. And also in our previous email conversations, I kind of got the gist, I think, of what people might be interested in hearing from me and my experience. I became a member of the Swedish Pirate Party in the founding year 2006, because I was a free and open source software girl at the time, and one of my friends told me that I needed to join a party which wanted to have more free and open source software development in the public sector. Actually, I've let my membership in the party lapse in spring of 2016 for a number of different reasons that I will not go into in depth in this presentation, but you're welcome to ask me about if you want. So I've named my presentation Piracy, Politics and Power. I hope to cover some of the founding story of the Pirate Party. Why was there at all a political party? Why was there a political party in Sweden, and how come it spread to such a lot of different countries after it was founded, and what happened in those countries like Germany, Iceland, the Czech Republic, also a success story which is less well known. It's about politics because, of course, if you're in a political party and you aim to get elected into a representative institution somehow, you want to be involved in politics and affect change, not only on the way that technology is developed, but also on the legislative framework which governs technology and the economic circumstances in which technology is built. I talk about power because part of my experiences from the European Parliament was that being powerful is very terrifying, and it's something that you need to have a lot of respect for. And also, when you consider politicians that are in the position that they can wield that amount of power, it's useful to be aware of the fact that often they know that they are very powerful and that what the consequences of what they do are. But so first of all, who am I? Well, I was a member of the European Parliament between 2011 and 2014. If any of you have studied European policy, politics, and I know at least one of the people in the audience has, you will know this is not a full legislature, and I will get into the reasons for this later. Since 2015, I run a non-profit organization in Sweden that focuses on data protection and information security for consumers, because after I came back from Brussels in 2014, I realized that a lot of the Swedish public discourse and institutions and companies and individuals are woefully unprepared to deal with the consequences of the new European data protection laws that enter into effect in 2018. So we aim to fill some of the gaps that we believe that the data protection authority, for formal reasons, will not be able to fill. For about 3 months, I've been with the Center for Internet and Society at their cybersecurity program, but I also feel free to impose on them all of my experiences of EU telecommunications competition law whenever they ask me for it, or whenever they don't ask me for it, because I also thoroughly enjoy competition law in the telecommunications sector. And as a side note, I also have actually completed my bachelor in mathematics finally. So you may think of me a mathematician now that I am no longer an honorable member. So the reason for why we had a pirate party in Sweden is actually kind of complicated and a long story. It goes all the way back to the 1990s. I put in two organizations here that you may be familiar with. But Sweden was a very early adopter of internet technologies. We had the government very involved in rolling out broadband and fiber infrastructures and having good institutions in place for domain names and through internet exchanges all the way back in the 1990s. In the end of the 1990s, a lot of Swedish municipalities were actively involved in helping children become accustomed to computers and learning how to operate, you know, computer interfaces, having high-speed broadband connections in their houses, even though over ADSL, but all the same, connectivity in Sweden was fairly ubiquitous. And it was also combined with the liberalization of the telecommunications sector that made it very easy for new market entrants and competitors to the former state monopolist to enter into the market and provide services. So this created fertile ground for lots of kids with powerful computers that also had good connectivity. And as you might expect, a lot of them started using them for file sharing and sharing of culture and computer games or films or pornographic images, if that were the case. But I think mostly quite harmful stuff, and definitely game file sharing was a bears, the bears. For this reason, the movie industry and the music industry decided to form an organization called the Anti-Piracy Bureau, because they wanted to teach the kids not to copy that fucking and how to behave properly online, that Napster is evil and destroying culture, and that artists are starving on the streets. Because we had such a large internet culture by that time, a group of very engaged netizen and internet activists formed this artistic group called the Pirate Bureau. The Pirate Bureau was formed as an antithesis of the Anti-Piracy Bureau to discover what happens if actually you don't condemn online piracy. What happens if you accept it and you say, this is a cool thing, it helps people develop culture, and what can people do with it? The Pirate Bureau are also the people who are responsible in the first place for forming the Pirate Bay. What happens when you put the torrent tracker out there on the internet and you don't impose any ratios and you allow the network of the seeds and the leechers to self-regulate? What kind of morality do you get in this space? What kind of culture do you end up having shared, and so forth? And of course, the Pirate Bureau and also the Pirate Bay were extremely important to how Swedish online culture later formed. The Pirate Bay became an internationally famous site, one of the most trafficked sites on the planet. People all over the world know it and have some form of personal experience to it if they had access to an internet connection. And it was kind of a pride of the nation that we could have these three young men who formed such an internationally renowned and still controversial service. So because we had that service in Sweden, in 2005, when the Swedish government decided to implement a European Copyright Act, which was originally written in 2001, but made it illegal to do file sharing, that created a lot of bad feelings. So the founder of the Pirate Party, Rick Falfinia, in January of 2006 thought, well, you know, if only showing politicians and people with power that you can create such amazing things as the Pirate Bay, with just an internet connection and a few basic computers, isn't enough to make them understand that the copyright framework is wrong, then surely the only way to have these laws changed is by going into the legislature and affecting them directly. And it turned out that this was a very popular idea. The party formed fairly easily. You need in Sweden 2,000 signatures before you can form, like handwritten signatures in a paper, before you can form a political party. He acquired it overnight. In about a month, there have been pirate parties cropping up in lots of different countries like Austria and Germany, Belgium, the Netherlands. So lots of people felt inspired and compelled by this idea that you need to go into the legislature in order to affect the laws. We also had in the beginning a lot of people coming in that cared about other aspects of online culture. So early cryptocurrency fans. This was way before Bitcoin, right? But you still had in the digital sphere at that time a lot of people who were thinking about the sustainability of the financial system. What does this mean? Of course, there were a lot of people in Europe at this time that cared about free software, like software patents, and what the implications of software patents would be on European entrepreneurship, and they also came into the party somehow. And that's where the Pirate Party really began. The founder of the Pirate Party does not have anything to do with the Pirate Bureau. He was never a member of the Pirate Bureau. He's not even very, I guess, somebody you would consider an artist. He's more of a businessy person, like a startup entrepreneurial type of person, not somebody who thinks in colors and how to entertain others. We founded the party in 2006 because of the first elections were in September of 2006. So the idea was if you could flash start a party, run an excellent campaign in 9 months, and conquer the legislature, then everything would be fine. We also had the strategy that we would be a wedge between the two big blocs of Swedish policy. So we have a conservative party bloc and a left-wing party bloc, and the Pirate Party's idea was that we could be right in the middle of those so that we would decide whoever gets to form the government. We could be able to make demands that would actually carry weight because we would be the arbitrator about who wins and who loses the elections finally. It didn't quite work out that way. We got less than 1% of the vote, and you need at least 4% to end up in the parliament. So even though the Pirate Party was able to gather a lot of enthusiasm, it wasn't enough to convince voters at that time that only copyright issues were important enough for somebody to vote for us. So that set up a bit of a crisis in the party that if this doesn't work, then how should we do? But we fortunately had some members that were extremely talented with organizational bits, and we formed the youth movement in order to get grants from the government. So youth organizations in Sweden typically can get a lot of funding from the government to create a meaningful free time for young persons. Because the member base of the Pirate Party was anyway very young, we deduced if we could get 6,000 of our members to join the youth movement and then form their own local grouping of young pirates, we would be able to get millions of krona from the government, which is something like hundreds of thousands of euros. And we were quite successful with that. I ended up on the first board of the youth movement because they needed, in order to get the funding from the government, you need to have equal representation of men and women on your board. So I was a co-director that helped the youth organization rise to financial prominence. And to this day, I think the youth movement of the Pirate Party is the more wealthy organization between the Pirate Party and the youth movement. It's very easy in Sweden to get funding for youth activities, especially if you help young people decide for themselves how to spend their free time. So the youth movement kind of worked and hogged money for a few years. And the next big event in the party's history is not until 2009 when we had the European elections. And this requires some background work also for me to explain to you, which is, I was working in the youth organization in their board, mostly by accident, because they needed a girl to show that they had girls. But I took a liking to international issues, and I started following the affairs at the World Intellectual Property Organization, in the European Union, what about document transparency in these organizations, how do we think about things like the Secure Standards Project at the World Customs Organization, which is the precedent of the anti-counterfeiting trade agreement that some of you may have heard about. Does anyone here not know what the anti-counterfeiting trade agreement is? ACTA. Mostly all of you. So the anti-counterfeiting trade agreement was a big trade agreement negotiated between 13 governments in the world, explicitly to exclude countries such as India and Brazil from dictating what the global best standards on intellectual property rights enforcement would be, online and otherwise. The secure standards at the World Customs Organization was the kind of precedent. So the United States and the European Union and a bunch of other states like Japan and so forth, they had realized that India was quite well represented in the World Intellectual Property Organization and Brazil as well. So that meant whenever they tried to push crazy stuff through the United Nations White Book Organization, they couldn't because the Indians would be there and say, hey, listen, this is not in our interest. But they identified that in the World Customs Organization, Indians, Brazilians, and Russians were not mobilized. So they had no intellectual property rights experts there, and therefore could not make adequate resistance against the pushing of bad ideas. And it took, I think, the Indian government and the Brazilian government a few years to catch up with this, but as soon as they did, also the secure standards of the World Customs Organization was dead. And I worked a lot with this in the youth organization. And I remember this because I was so happy that the Indians were able to quash a project. I thought it was very cool, and then came ACTA as a kind of reanimated but more evil version of this. Because I was such a prominent voice on international issues in the youth movement, I had the fortune ahead of the European elections that they again needed a quota girl. Because they had sort of decided already who was going to be the top of the list in the party. And it was this older guy who was a former software patent activist from Stockholm. He'd been very active in the anti-software patent campaign in Brussels between 2002 and 2006. And he'd been keeping a blog and keeping, you know, the members interested in these issues for a long time. But because he was kind of an old man from Stockholm, he wasn't very demographically representative of Sweden. Even if Stockholm is the largest city, most people in Sweden actually don't live there. And also most people were, you know, a significant part of the population is not an old white man. So I was then kind of a good choice for the party to put on place two on the list because there was a young woman who lived in the south of Sweden at the time. So I ended up on the second place of the list. And that was very exciting because it's a big responsibility already to be at the second place of the list. But it turned out even worse, for me at least personally, because the Pirate Bay people, by this time, had managed to get themselves exposed to a raid by the police in 2006, which was seen as wildly unjust by most of the Swedish population, and it had taken the prosecutors 2 years to prepare the trial, which began in spring of 2009, just a few months before the elections. On the 28th, I think, of April, which is 1.5 months before the European elections of 2009, these three young men who built the wildly popular Pirate Bay service were convicted to several years to be in jail and millions of euros in fines. And lots of people were terribly angry with the government for allowing that to happen. Also, the legal case against them was a bit arbitrary because since copyright law mostly places liability on the person that actually infringes on the copyright, and these people have really only provided a kind of search engine to bits and pieces of copyrighted materials. They had to really tweak the law to make them viable for something. So one of the people went down for flicking a switch at the server at one point in 2005, and these kind of really fishy things. And it created a huge interest in the Pirate Party, and we soared up to, I think, 9% in the opinion polls ahead of the elections. At which time it became barely obvious to me that I might become a member of the parliament, which I had not expected when I said yes to being on the second place of the list. Because being in a position of power is a terrifying thing. And even if we ended up getting only 7.2% of the vote, this happened to be just enough for me to actually kind of be sort of elected, which I will return to apparently at the later slide. Meanwhile, when the Pirate Party was gaining a lot of successes in Sweden because of the spectral thing, which was the Pirate Bay trial, we also had the German Pirate Party growing very strong. The German Pirate Party was founded in 2006 also, kind of at the same time as the Swedish Pirate Party. But they were taking different routes from the Swedish Pirate Party in terms of how they organized their internal organization and also in terms of what policies they were pushing. The one big difference between the German pirates and the Swedish pirates is that the Swedish pirates were always very well prepared for participating in a representative democracy. The German pirates more acquired disappointed members of, I think, the Green Party that wanted direct democracy to a larger extent. They built their own software systems for direct voting, for enabling more participation in, you know, policy making in real time. They also built accountability systems where you could easily get rid of parliamentarians or political leaders that you felt were not up to the task of responsibly managing the power that you had given to them. The Icelandic Pirate Party was sort of formed in the wake of the financial crisis in 2008, but really, and I think a lot of you may be familiar with this, that they rose to political prominence first only with the WikiLeaks collateral damage videos, which showed the American troops treating some people in Iraq very, very badly, and now also in the last few years they've been extremely successful in a way that I think other parties in Europe have not so far been. At this time we also had a lot of fledgling kind of international cooperation movements, which mostly took the form of emailing lists, and most of them at this time, they still exist. Like, there is an international pirate party, or Pirate Parties International, I think the organization is formed, it's based in Belgium, it works kind of so-so. There is also a European Pirate Party, or a party of European pirates. I think they call themselves the PEP, not to be confused with the European Conservative Bloc, which is also called otherwise EPP. And we have lots more youth movements in Europe, especially in Europe, because the Swedish youth funding schemes have the natural advantage of You can disseminate them to other youth movements if you have formal collaborations. So Sweden is always kind of active for any type of youth movement in Europe. It's kind of a money pot where the government gives lots of money, which is then disseminated into youth movements all over Europe for fruitful cooperation. I became the MEP-elect in 2009 because we had 7.2% of the vote. But there was a kind of treaty technicality in the European Union, which was the parent party could only have 2 seats in the European Parliament. We had our top guy, the old guy from Stockholm, and we could only have my seat if the European Parliament renewed its treaties. And the European Union is an organization of governments, so all of the governments need to agree to update these things, and it takes a lot of time. It's a very controversial process. They'd sort of been working on it since 2003, and they thought they had an agreement, but then there was a referendum in Ireland, and the Irish people were not in agreement with the political people in Ireland. There was no treaty, and my seat was kind of rocketing. So what would happen when the Lisbon Treaty eventually entered into effect was that Sweden would have, instead of 18 seats, 20 seats. And the 2 extra seats, one of them was mine and the other would go to the Social Democrat, which we needed for all of the member states to re-ratify what is called the Lisbon Treaty, the treaty that updates the old treaties and awards Sweden these 2 seats. So I spent about 2.5 years in a limbo where I wasn't sure, was I elected or was I not elected? I was not really listed on the Parliament website. I had contact with all of the other people in Europe that would also become MEPs when the Lisbon Treaty entered into effect. And we were keeping track of when the member states were signing also and sending letters, you know, asking when will you act on this issue. And it turned out in the end that, the member state that dragged out the longest was Belgium. So we were sitting for, I think, 6 months waiting for the Wallonian Parliament to sign off on the Lisbon Treaty. And if it pleases anyone to know, but maybe it doesn't, the Canadian Cooperation Agreement, the CETA, which is a big trade agreement that the European Union negotiated with Canada, it was also held up recently in the Wallonian Parliament. So the Wallonian Parliament is kind of the staller of the European Union. They ensure that they have proper procedure and afterthought before we rush into things, but they also kept me from my position for 2 years. So I will say this, in their defense, that had I entered into the Parliament directly in 2009, I would have been a considerably worse MEP. The 2.5 years that I got to stay outside of the Parliament and see the processes and talk to lobbyists and people in the Commission, while being sort of in power, but not formally in power, was extremely helpful to me. And it helped me understand how you maneuver Brussels, how do you find out who to talk to, how do you address those people to not, you know, seriously anger them? And why it is important always to Google whether a German has finished a doctoral degree. So all of these things that when I was 21 and young, I would not have realized by 2011, when I actually assumed my position in the Parliament, I was very well equipped to deal with. And I was also equipped to deal with how to fix my policy priorities. I had the time to read up on what the Parliament had done in the past, what its failings had been, and how you can play out, you know, how you play out the political process in as an effective way as possible. While I was waiting to become an MEP, in Brussels there were some crucial developments that I felt I should include because I gave my talk in more general notion than just the pirate party, which is, first of all, my colleague, Christian Engström, entered into this role in the Parliament. So that is quite significant because he was the first pirate MEP. He was immediately responsible for, he took charge of internal market issues, which include patents, trademarks, copyrights, really core issues of the Pirate Party. I think he was also in the Legal Affairs Committee, you might not expect, but copyright in many European countries is seen as a moral right, a human right, rather than an economic right. So it's often dealt with as a constitutional issue, a matter of, you know, governments having a duty to protect the intellectual works of others, rather than as an economic right, as in how can I ensure that I have enough money to pay for myself. He was doing that. But perhaps an even more significant development in Brussels in 2009 was that a European umbrella group of digital rights organizations called the European Digital Rights, or EDRI for short, got their first professional policy person in Brussels. And what the Evry was able to do in Brussels at that time was give a credible and non-policy partisan voice to some of the concerns that faces the digital environment. Because this was a professional policy person, they were also able to provide briefings, they had a lot of experience on how to maneuver Brussels, how to ask questions to the Commission in a way as to infuriate them. And so the Evry has done, I think, more good work in Brussels over the last few years than any elected representative could have done on their own. And it would happen many times that I would consider my actions in the European Parliament in relation to Edwards. So if you think in policy-wise, you often talk about the rubber band effect, which is if you stretch the extremes a bit, the middle also ends up further to where you want to go, right? So my idea was if I'm a bit more extreme in the Parliament, then Edry is going to be the sensible people in the middle, and they will be able to more easily than me argue that the Christian Democrats or the Social Democrats should listen to them because they represent somehow the voice of human rights, of consumer rights, and citizen concerns online.
Good call, bad call.
Right, yes. With me as the inexplicably the bad call. Yeah. But it worked, so it worked quite well, and the Edry people are still, they're much larger now, so they have 5 people, I think, permanently based in Brussels, and this is still not enough to cover the entirety of all of the policy processes that are there, because as you know, in India, digital topics has a way of just spreading out across all different sectors, and so many different sectors by now are implicated by, you know, privacy or digital rights or even how do we construct, you know, liability and security in these environments in a way that's useful for individuals. It's very complicated, they're vastly underfunded, but they do a lot of good work, and 2009 was the starting year, and you can kind of see how the Parliament becomes more susceptible to digital rights arguments after the Evry is there. Before I became the MEP in 2011, formerly, the Pirate Bureau, which is the artistic collective that started the Pirate Bay, decided to close down either temporarily or permanently. This was in 2010, because they got kind of bored with the Pirate Party, I think. They also got bored with the Pirate Bay. The graphical user interface wasn't really updating, they felt it wasn't contributing anything new to the discussion on online cultures, and they announced that they had closed down. They didn't say that they had closed down permanently, but because in 2016 they're still closed, I think for all intents and purposes we can consider them permanently shut down. The members of the Pirate Bureau went on to do a lot of different things in Swedish policy debates. Most of them have become academics. Some of them now work in the government. One I know became a medical doctor, or they, you know, work on different types of academic or artistic projects still, but that relate to online cultures in different ways than Falshare. Because the digital sphere, after all, we can do a lot of things with the internet that are not, you know, violating copyrights. And so that was the kind of end of an era. In 2010, the Swedish media, in particular, reacted very strongly to how the pirate movement had died. And for various reasons, this was also very harmful to the Pirate Party, because the Pirate Party did not have at this time, the intellectual capacity to develop their own understanding of what online culture should or could be, let's say. So it was a significant event for us. I became the MEP on December 1st in 2011 after the signed the treaty. This was an extremely terrifying experience to me. I had moved to Belgium in 2010. For some personal reasons in my life that made it convenient for me to relocate from Sweden at that time, even though I wasn't an MEP. But I discovered in Belgium that Belgium has nothing of the sort of telecommunications infrastructure that Sweden has. So while in Sweden in the 90s, municipalities and the government had been very deliberately investing in infrastructure for telecommunications and ensuring that people could have personal computers in their homes and that they were familiar with these computers to use them, thereby breeding the ground for, you know, creating a fertile ground for all of these small file-sharing copyright hooligans to pop up. In Belgium, they had done no such thing. Belgium has terrible competition on the telecommunications market still. Even though they are a Western European country, at this time, in Belgium, there are no fiber-to-the-home connections. There are no consumers in Belgium that have fiber connectivity delivered to the home. They have a telecommunications duopoly in most of the country, which is dominated by the former state monopolist, Belcacom, that owns the copper cables. That's ADSL, and some of you will be familiar with ADSL not being supremely quick. And then they also have a cable monopoly, which was formed in the 1980s by some Dutch guy, I think, coming in just buying municipal cable networks for television. But instead of utilizing the fantastic opportunities of coaxial cable, what they did was impose downloading quotas or traffic quotas every month. So I've been sitting in my university apartment in Sweden with a 10 megabit symmetric connection, which I had bought very cheaply for €5 a month, because I thought I didn't need the 100 megabit symmetric connection, surely, for €10 per month, because that would be overdoing it. And when I came to Belgium, my landlord asked me if I could start downloading YouTube films instead of watching the same film over and over, because I was eating into our quota. It did not compute with me that Belgium could be so terrible that you have only 4 gigabytes of internet traffic in an apartment in a month. Like, how can they have, in 2010, not developed past this stage? So what had happened in 2011, after the initial shock of discovering, you know, a third world country amongst the Western European states, was I thought I need to go to Eastern Europe, because if Belgium can be so surprising to me, and affect me so much in how I view. So this has a lot of consequences for Belgium. You must imagine also that they don't have a file sharing culture. There's nobody in Belgium that was ever able to use the Pirate Bay in an unfettered way, because it would immediately eat your quota. You have no download speed, or you have no upload speeds also. I've been given this membership at a torrent tracker called Karagarga, which was for novelty films. And as soon as I moved to Belgium, I was shut out, because whenever I tried to upload any of the stuff that I had, you know, downloaded or even put my own stuff on the server, there was always some Romanian or a Swedish person or somebody with much better upload speeds that would take all of the leeches. And I wouldn't get any, because I only had 0.3, you know, megabit per second, and I would see all of my ratio disappear, and then finally Karagarga decided on an automated basis that I was not worthy of participating in their community. It was extremely frustrating. So I decided to go to Romania to see if Romania was equally surprising to Belgium, under the hypothesis that if you're going to be the MEP for all of these 500 million people in the European Union and also represent online cultures and the cross-border nature of such cultures, you should at least have the decency to explore what are the different challenges facing people in Europe on this front. And Romania turned out to be very surprising. Romania has excellent broadband. Even if you go on the countryside, I mean, I know we consider Romania in the European Union probably a bit poor. If some of you follow European policies, you will know Romania causes a lot of controversy because they have corruption and they have, you know, lots of demographic problems and otherwise. But their internet infrastructure, there's nothing wrong with it. It's very good. Even if you go in the middle of the countryside to some small city with just 5,000 people, you will easily have 75 megabit symmetric. And they have lots of coaxial cable. It turns out Romania had a lucky break in the 1990s, because the old regime, the communist regime that was in place until 1989, did not prioritize telephony, so only about 20% of all Romanians had a phone in 1989. So in the 90s, when they built their infrastructure, they didn't build copper, they built directly fiber, and they benefited from that. They also had very good mathematics education in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. And apparently
there.
Sure. So, but also in 1990, there was this guy who had gone into exile in the US from Romania, defected from the regime, and he came back to Romania with 30,000 Unix manuals that the Romanians read heartily. And so the country began in the 1990s with no state debt, excellent infrastructure, and lots of Unix administrators. So for this reason, Romania is still actually a prominent IT country in the European Union, and it's their one successful industry, let's say, that they have now. And also, where are you?
Is it the fastest internet in the world?
Moldova. It's even better. Moldova. The Republic of Moldova, which is it's the poorest country in Europe.
Yes.
They're not a member of the European Union, but they have the fastest broadband connections. It's true. And in fact, the two people who formed altnet.md, which is a local ISP, not even in the capital, but so the capital of Moldova is called Chisinau. And then there's this other smaller city close to Chisinau, the name of which escapes me at this time. And there they have an internet service provider called Altnet, and the people that founded Altnet also tried to form a Moldovan pirate party. So they used to come to some of the European pirate party conferences, and they're super nice people, but Moldova faces a lot of problems that are unrelated to kind of copyright, that their primary problem is, I think, that public institutions are completely unpredictable. They have a lot of corruption, and this is not doing very well for them. So that was an issue. But so when I received the announcement of my sudden ascension into one of the 751 most powerful people in Europe, I was in Romania chilling out, going to the gym and talking to ANCOM officials, which is the kind of tri of Romania, and also speaking with their free software community. So it was kind of unsettling to me because I was discovering a country that I had not been in before, and then suddenly I had to go to Strasbourg, which was a terrible place to be at. I was terrified to be in the parliament. I had suddenly an office in, you know, lots of different countries. It was very scary. I also could not find the canteen in Strasbourg. So the first week that I was in Strasbourg, I had a lack of sleep and I couldn't find the food. That was not the best start to a parliamentary career. But it ended up all right after a while. They have a canteen in Strasbourg, it turns out. So you can actually eat there. I thought you were kind of reduced to just sandwiches with tuna things in it. It was a ghastly experience. I also had to do this media interview where they would ask me lots of very arbitrary questions about the internal machinations of the Green Group, and I wasn't sure how much I could talk about them. And also the other MEPs can be really scary, because you don't know how to address them. And in the parliament, when you're an MEP, all of the people who work there serve you, so you're king. Whenever you walk, like people will go, oh, Madame the MEP, it's an extremely daunting experience that I had not been prepared for before that time. Even though I had been in Brussels and seeing all of these things happening there for a long time, there was nothing that could have helped me understand what it means to be an ultimate and power over other people and have them all happy to serve me. Because I'd already been in Brussels for 2.5 years at this time, I had some friends inside the parliament administration that I knew were not only there to kind of suck up, because this is by far the biggest problem when you become an MEP, that you're so enthralled by all of the people complimenting you and telling you how great you are because they need your favors, that you become full of yourself and believe that you're actually great. Because I had spent 2.5 years chatting with commission people and lobbyists about how dumb most MEPs are, I felt extremely humbled by the experience and tried to not be dumb. But one of the policy advisors of the Green Group, who thought it was interesting and nice that there was a young girl working on tech issues coming into the parliament, had decided that I would be given the opinion in the industry committee for the anti-counterfeiting trade agreement that I spoke of earlier. And so what you will understand about this agreement was, because this had already been a process that was maneuvered in international organizations for about 10 years before I came into the parliament, and the European governments and the US government and Japan and all of these governments had been trying to escape failing with such standards at the global level by forming this agreement, when I entered into the parliament, it looked quite clear that the agreement would pass. So my cynical understanding of what happened is the policy advisor wanted to give me a chance, and the Green Group, where I was a member, thought, why not? Because if she fails, she's not a Green. And you know, this is bound to fail. As it turned out, 1 month or 2 months after I entered the parliament on the 17th of January in 2012, about 2 million Polish people decided that ACTA was a really bad agreement, and that they would riot until it went away. This caused a lot of political upheaval in Europe because it meant something that nobody had questioned for, you know, 10 years that this would come to pass. Suddenly, it wasn't obvious that this would be the way to go forward. So for instance, the Polish Christian Democrats, which is a big delegation of the Christian Democrats in the European Parliament, had to kind of listen to the people. My opinion then became much more a question of, instead of getting the parliament not to approve the agreement at this time, see how can we make this into rejecting the agreement. I was fortunate also to be on the International Trades Committee, which meant that I could be the what you call the shadow rapporteur, or somebody following the main report in the International Trades Committee. So I was working on two different sides in the parliament to get this passed. To cut a long story short, I can talk about this for a long time clearly, but we won, and the parliament rejected the ACT agreement on the 4th of July, I think, 2012. It was a great victory. And even when I won in my committee, because my committee, the industry committee, was the first committee whose opinion said to reject. So that was also a massive victory for me as a kind of new MEP that I could just waltz in and get 2 million Polish people to protest in my favor. I think I got a lot of respect from my colleagues for that. Unfortunately, because I was dealing very well with the ACTA opinion in the industry committee, another policy advisor in the Greens did me a favor and gave me an opinion in the International Trades Committee on some form of digital rights strategy for the United Nations, and that didn't go as well. I was completely outmaneuvered by the British Tories. Why to speak about failures when we cannot do that? I also quickly had to learn as a parliamentarian that you're not alone in your office, and you cannot be. Your staff are extremely important. They organize your life, they tell you when to go to meetings, they help you make traveling arrangements, they even can help you answer emails. I had huge difficulties with this at first because I wanted to have control over my own email account, since it's my identity, it says my name in it. And if somebody sends an email from this account, it should be me, I thought, naively. And I quickly had to back down from this because we have lots of problems with the administration, because you need to fill in lots of papers, and somebody needs to keep track of when the administration is contacting you. So after a while, everyone in my office had access to my email account. And I tried to tell them that you can't send emails from my email account. But then it turns out when voters write to you, they become very unhappy if you're not the one responding. At some time, they also got to write emails in my name. And that was extremely frustrating and scary. So we launched the concept of the extended me. There's kind of me, the individual, and my office was the extended me. And everyone in my office had to make peace with the fact that they were somehow me. We tried to make a kind of infotainment video series about our office called Exile 16. Unfortunately, I'm a terrible media person, so most of the episodes are probably quite boring. But they're still on YouTube if you're interested in seeing what my different staff members are like. We still keep in touch, and I'm very happy to say that we had a good working environment, which I've heard from other MEPs' offices. It's not always the case. And I believe that we also accomplished miracles, for instance, having the ACTA agreement rejected. We held a small celebration in my office afterwards when I presented my fellow MEPs with lots of different exciting potatoes that I had found in Belgian supermarkets, which added to my eccentricity with my parliament peers. And I put also that in 2012, what happened when the ACTA agreement was rejected was also another organization, NGO, was founded in Brussels, Access Now. Well, they're an American organization and they work there with kind of access issues. Some of you would know them because they're very active in, you know, non-European countries. But they've also now started contributing a lot to the European policy debates on encryption and informing European legislators about data protection in countries outside of Europe. And they thought this would be interesting to know in a more general way. The Pirate Bay, in spite of the Pirate Bureau closing down, somehow lived on during these years, and the Pirate Party assumed ownership of the Pirate Bay, because a lot of people internationally were anyway confusing us with the Pirate Bay or the Pirate Bureau, and the Pirate Party felt that the Pirate Bay was an important symbol of their policy and what we wanted to achieve. But the Pirate Bay has always been in a complicated relationship with the party, because it's first of all not our project, and it's also not clear exactly what we would do with it except keep it, you know, up. And it's kind of true that it's not a very interesting project because it's not being developed. The graphical user interface is the same now as it was in 2004. And normally we would hope that people move on to other technologies and trackers after some time. Our final cut with the Pirate Bay was after the King is stepped down as a party leader in 2010, and the new party leader received a letter from the Anti-Piracy Bureau, which had by now changed name to the Rights Alliance, that unless you sever your ties with the Pirate Bay, we'll sue you and your partner out of your houses. And then the
which year?
This would have been in 2013, because I remember I was very upset with the party leader in 2013, because I thought of it as a kind of betrayal that you give up on this important symbol. But the fact of the matter is also that she was restricted in her house and lots of other very nasty things. The rights lobby is not easy to mess with for a number of different reasons. They use underhanded tactics and they're also very scary. And so when she decided to quit the Pirate Bay, kind of affiliation of the party, the Pirate Bay still lived on, but I don't know who maintains it now. It's just this kind of project that refuses to die, I guess.
Would the rights organization have support from other big corporations then?
Well, the rights, so rights organizations, there's lots of rights organizations. but normally the ones that send letters, they would be from either the Movie Pictures Association of America or the MPAA, or we have also the RIAA, and then you have various European installments of these organizations also. So the European MPA that represents kind of Hollywood interests in Europe, but then in Europe also, because we have 28 different member states and all of them have different film industries and recording industries, you have a bunch of other actors as well. And one very important player in the European policy landscape is, two very important players, I should say, three. GEMA, the German Collecting Society. Do you have collecting societies in India? Do you know what they do?
So
CMO, Collective Rights Management Organization. They allow for artists or filmmakers or, you know, these types of people to become members of their collective. And then they collect licenses from companies like Google or the radio station or the television, and they distribute it to their members.
Yes.
And they have.
I think we have something similar, because most radios need a borrower to pay licenses.
Sure.
It comes from, I think it's not Indian music industry.
Yeah. So it's like GEMA is the German one, and SACEM is the French one, and PRS is the British one. And they're very important for users of copyrighted content, because they create a single point of litigation, also for artists, that instead of, you know, a TV station kind of having to have a lawsuit with every individual artist that has made a piece of music ever, they can argue it out with the collective rights management organization, and then the artist, instead of arguing with the TV station, can go to the CMO, and that's where they are. In the US and probably in India as well, what will happen is that artists can join if they want to. And also radio stations or TV stations can sign a contract with these organizations if they want to. And the way that it's done in European governments that have often been, you know, kind of social democratic or have strong collectivist tendencies is that you have to sign a contract with the CMO, and as an author you have to be a member, because otherwise you're screwed. So these organizations can be very powerful. The PRS at one point in time was advocating that all internet users should be given audiovisual signals for when they stumbled across copyrighted content, so that they could know not to pirate it.
I just remember that the Indian music industry was formed in 1936. It's the second oldest collective rights organization.
I see. Well, for India has also had some kind of.
Their registration expired a few years ago. What happened to that?
I don't know.
What if you mentioned?
They let it lapse.
IMI, Indian Music Industry.
Yeah, the registration lapsed and they were still collecting money even though they were not actually registered anymore.
But that happens. Like also, so the collective rights management organizations are a bit of a problem. Politically, they're also very strong because they're normally tied to the entirety of the creative community of their member state, since everyone has to join them. Well, for various reasons, they're very politically important, even though sometimes they have extremely dumb ideas. Such as when the French Collecting Society wanted everyone to pay a broadband tax to compensate rights holders for piracy without making piracy legal. So you would pay for doing something that if you get caught, you would then get sued for. It's like paying for nothing at all. And this proposal, unsurprisingly, gained a lot of traction in France.
France also had a tax on every CD and recordable CD and DVD sold. You know, there was a piracy tax.
No, they wanted to have it abroad then.
No, but they had it on CDs already there.
Yeah, yeah.
They're already there on media.
No, we have that also. And in Belgium, the collecting agency that I forget what they're called, Sagem or Samek, something also beginning with SA. They managed to make it so that that truck drivers that listen to the radio while shipping stuff have to pay remuneration to Sabam because they're listening to music during work hours. But if they keep the radio on while they're on toilet break, they will have to pay. And this is inspiring.
Should ideally the radio stations be paying?
The radio stations are already paying. But the truck drivers are also paying if they are in motion transporting goods. But not, for instance, if their truck is empty and they're going back.
So work versus non-work.
Yes. So it means that they're collecting double rents on the broadcasting of their music, and they're getting away with it. Because they're, as I said, very politically powerful. So it's a big problem in Europe, as I guess in India as well.
Yeah, actually.
And worldwide. So, but anyway, so those people that have all these crazy ideas and also lots of lawyers, but in the party, we don't have a party, the party base. Shout out to our organization, that is that. I skip ahead for a few years because I'll get back to some of the important policy beats that we did in the parliament later. In 2014, and you will have known this if you already looked at the first slide of my presentation where it showed that I stopped being an MP in 2014, we lost both of our seats. That was a big defeat for the Pirate Party. Normally, a political party is not meant to lose two incumbent seats. I think one of the reasons that we lost these two seats was that the defeat over the Pirate Bay, so giving up on an important symbol for the party, while at the same time realizing that digital issues are indeed quite complex, and especially in Europe, they're really very, very difficult, caused the party to diverge into other areas of policy where we just were not competitive. And so we ended up losing to other political parties that were better able to capitalize on the public mood, while also claiming expertise in those areas where people were most concerned. The German Pirate Party did conquer one seat in the European Parliament, and the current member of the European Parliament for the Pirates is called Julia Riva. She is working on the copyright reform that the Commission initiated in September of this year, but she's just the one person. As far as I understand, the copyright reform in Brussels isn't actually going terrible because we also have a very strong library lobby right now. The Czech Pirates in the EU elections in 2014, they narrowly missed one seat. They're often overlooked because in the Czech Republic, apparently English is not taught much and they're not very strong English speakers. But the Czech Pirate Party is actually very active. They have municipal seats all over the country. And their big gig is kind of anti-corruption, because in the Czech Republic, like in many other Eastern European states, they have the problem of a weak institutional framework that isn't able to function regularly. So in most of the Eastern European states, in every election, you have at least one party that is able to conquer seats, because they say that they will deal with some of the difficulties that arise from corruption. Iceland is not part of the European Union, so they don't run for the European Parliament elections. But I think in Iceland, it's the same thing as in the Czech Republic, that they've been able to capitalize very well in Iceland on kind of anti-establishment moves. What happened in Iceland after the financial crisis was essentially because the Icelandic people understood that the bankers were corrupt, the politicians were in on it, And they have some of these prominent political people like Birgitta Jonsdottir exposing also military corruption in large Icelandic cooperation partners. Iceland was labeled a terrorist government by the British government in 2009 or 2010, which is a, you know, quite strong condemnation of a government by another government. And so Icelandic people have felt frustrated that their politicians can't deal with banking regulations and the finances of the government in a better way. And the pirate party says that they are able to present an alternative to this. Which means effectively also that the Icelandic pirates may not have rose so much to prominence because of the crowdsourced constitution or because of any direct democratic, you know, web application or because of the copyright issues or file sharing issues or even internet issues, but just a general fatigue in the population that also in the summer when the prime minister had to resign because he was hiding lots of assets in Panama. It's just not the type of thing that you want to find out about your prime minister. I don't know if in India the tolerance would maybe be higher for this, but in some countries the tolerance, at least people would not be as surprised, but in Iceland I think they react with Scandinavian outrage and also extreme wariness of this. So the Icelandic pirates for this reason have turned into quite a political phenomenon. They were at one point polling at 42%. Now I think in the elections they got 14% of the votes and 10 seats out of 68 in the Icelandic parliament, and they were about to negotiate for government last week, but the negotiations broke down and now it's again not looking as if the pirate party will be part of the government. And this is also kind of difficult for a political party that first of all the delegation from the own party grows a lot, from 3 MEPs or 3 members of parliament that maybe are getting along with each other quite well, to 10. Getting along between 10 people is much more difficult than getting along through 3 people. But then if in addition you need to go into a government coalition and get along with all of these different people from different parties that have their own ideas, that is easily quite a challenge. It does not look as if they will be pulling off his feet in this election, but maybe in the next one. We're following them with great interest because the Icelandic political problems generally are likely to prevail over time. You know, old dogs don't learn how to sit, and I think this holds also for some of the older political parties in Iceland. The Czech pirates could also actually continue to grow. I don't follow them much because I don't speak Czech. But I know that the people that they have elected at the local level, they feel that they're being useful and helpful in their constituencies to raise issues against corruption and also some of the IT policy issues that the pirate party was originally founded to deal with. So while I was in the European Parliament, I worked on a host of different issues. These are some of the things. I put them all in one slide so I could speak freely about them. If ever you want to ask me a question on any particular topic, of course, you're likely to raise it. Normally, internet policy issues are the same thing all over the world. So, if in India you discuss copyright issues in international organizations, or internet governance, or neutrality, or, you know, online blocking and filtering, then the same thing is going on in Europe. Internet policy, I have always found, is the great transnational policy complex, because wherever you go, everyone who deals with it from the digital rights perspective is facing approximately the same types of challenges, and it's very easy to find friends in every country or every form of development in the world. The one time, yes?
So I just used to quote smart borders. Does that refer to electronically readable passports?
Yes, I think it's kind of the next stage. So smart borders could be the type of scanners where you have to stand like this so they take new photos of you and then just work
on that. No. Millimeter wave scanners at the airport.
Yeah, but you have like the regular ones where you just walk like this. And then there's also the ones where you have to stand like this and you get x-rayed so that you don't hide. Have you been to the United States?
So this one at airports, and there's a guy in a room looking at the scan, right? But at borders, I don't know how it works.
Airports have borders.
No, so I think they also collect your finger. The idea is they collect your fingerprints or your irises, and then they cross-run it to a database, and they have, like, basically it's lots of computers with data in them that they cross-reference about you when they call it smart. Normally, smart border investments and what kind of smart border investments are chosen by any particular country. is most easily mapped by looking at what type of domestic industry exists in that country. And so you see here that I have bundled smart borders with passports and smart cards. So the European Union was the first, I think, large-scale organization that went over on biometric passports because we happen to be the home country of most of the smart card industry. So the European smart card industry is the only successful European electronic industry, basically, the one we were at the forefront of making all of the public transport RFID cards that we use in London and Hong Kong and what have you, and also all of the passports and, you know, driver's licenses and so forth. It's all European. When you walk into your company in the morning and you stamp your card for the thing you work, that's also probably a European company that makes that. So Europe is very proud over these industries, and we were so proud over them that we wanted to give them the helpful subsidy of forcing 500 million people to buy two of their products every 5 years, which is effectively what it means to have standardized biometric passports and ID cards in Europe. This is the same with a lot of different telecommunications policies, like net neutrality and competition law I put in there because the vast majority of my time in the European Parliament was spent on telecommunications policy. Why is Belgium such a shitty place, basically? And it turns out the reason why in Germany, to this day, there are people our age who are stuck on 256 kilobit per second modems. That's all we're
seeing. Until today,
2016.
In 2016. And you wonder how the beep can still be something that people have to listen to before they get online.
What about 4G? There's no 4G like this.
Germany is such an interesting place. So it turns out what happens in these large countries like Germany, France, Spain, and Italy is because they used to have government-owned monopolies for telecommunications that covered 100% of the territory of the country. So not like in India, I heard that the BSNL, they covered about 20% of the people, right? So you didn't have a 100% coverage of telephony. But in all of these countries, they did. And because they were government-owned companies, the government would use them to regulate unemployment before Europe went over on kind of inflation control. So they have huge kind of staffs that a modern telecommunications operator with digital switches and maybe low fiber connections and so forth does not need. The best example that I have of this is really like in France, where they had a brief period of competitive glory between 2012 and 2014 after an operator called Free launched high-quality broadband services in Paris. And they were cheap, and they were fast, and the consumers loved it. Everyone was deserting Orange, the France Telecom, to go to Free because Free was superior in every possible way. And the French government thought, oh, this is excellent. Competition brings joy to our consumers. Voters would like us if we continue to push for this development, until in 2014, the French legislature realized that Orange employs France Telecom, employs 100,000 people, while Free employs 7,000 only. So what do you do with all of those 3,000 surplus employees if you don't allow France Telecom / Orange to continue operating the way they do? We have the same problem in Germany and in and kind of in the UK as well, with British Telecom. And often, all the state monopolist companies, they also have pension funds that they're liable for. So it's not only that they have a large amount of employees now that they don't need, it's also that they're responsible for financing the retirement of people that they used to employ at the time when the government was just feeding people into the system to keep unemployment down in society overall. And so that makes some of the competition issues and the neutrality issues in Europe extremely difficult, because if you expose the telcos to, you know, a greater amount of competition, they might have to sack people, and the politicians don't like that. And it's even at the stage where I heard once in Austria Telecom, which is the former monopolist there, they have about 3,000 employees that are formerly employees of the Ministry of Finance, only the Ministry of Finance will not pay for them, and also will not discuss how to recuperate them from the operator. So the operator is forced to be competitive while being responsible for people that they didn't sign the contract with. In mobile telephony, it's not really the same problem, but it's sort of the same problem. That you have some areas where it's very efficient to build up mobile infrastructure, like cities, and then you have the countryside, where it's not so efficient. And And different member states have chosen different ways of incentivizing telcos to go in the countryside. The most common way of doing this is because in order to be a mobile operator, you need to have a spectrum license from the government. This is the same in India. And by the way, if anyone knows, I would be interested to know if you have per state spectrum licenses in India, because you have domestic roaming. So. This makes sense because I noticed in India you have domestic roaming, which is of course in Europe a very familiar problem. But so what mostly happens is that the government would say that you get the spectrum license only if you also build infrastructure in these areas. And what they did in Germany was they gave a joint license to T-Mobile and Vodafone to build infrastructure in the countryside. But then the problem is that the countryside, of course, you have a duopoly owned infrastructure and you have to share it with the other operators. People in the countryside that use mobile production in Germany are still quite locked down in this way. Also, Europe was an early adopter of 3G technologies, unlike the United States. So the United States had the 2G investments in the 1990s, and then they went straight to 4G, basically. Whereas in Europe, we first rolled out the 2G and then the 3G, and then the switch to 4G has been kind of slow, because actually big industries like the mobile operators, they can't afford to replace their infrastructure every 5 years. It would be prohibitively expensive then to provide services to consumers. And I'm not quite sure what the EU legislator is now thinking, pushing 5G really quickly, because that seems to me also something that's going to cost a lot of money while adding very little benefit to consumers. Because actually 4G is, I guess, sufficient if also you ensure that you have good wired infrastructure. It does. Yes. So data protection became a big issue in the European Union in 2012 because we had an excellent commissioner for human rights at the time called Vivian Belling. She is a Luxembourgian Christian Democrat and somebody that if you're looking for a good female role model in politics, she's definitely it. She's done some insane stuff, or some stuff that I think was maybe not too well conceived, like introducing the roaming regulation, not a good choice. But she's also been, you know, always standing up for really cool policies. Like in 2006, she proposed that all the telcos in Europe be structurally separated, so that you have one layer for owning the infrastructure and another layer for providing access services, and that there can be no economic meddling between these layers and cross-subsidizing. And normally this is good because the investment cycles for these things are very different. If you want to be an access provider, you work on a financial cycle of maybe 10 years. But if you're digging a fiber cable into the ground, then surely you're digging it there for it to be there for 100 years. So the type of loans and mortgages that you would get for digging fiber into the ground are completely different from the ones that you would get for setting up switches and hubs or by, you know, household routers, which needs to be replaced, what, 6 months or so. And so Vivian Redding proposed a new data protection regulation in 2012, and that became a really big issue. But it turns out, in fact, the right to be forgotten, which was given a lot of attention kind of around the whole Spain case, it's already been in the European law since 1995. So even though a lot of noise has been made about the data protection regulation, it's actually not a lot of stuff that's new.
I think it would be a problem if it wasn't in the law, because people have the idea that it's going to be
so the right to be forgotten can be, so what the European court did, which was kind of, you know, has been criticized, is that they said Google is responsible for the information in their indices.
Which it is.
Which it is, right. So,
why is that problem?
Yeah, for all of the reasons that Jimmy Wells was upset with their censorship and so forth, and what if, you know, a politician escapes with the...
Like you mentioned Google, which is it true? I think that in most, Google has a separate set of privacy laws for the entire world, and there's a different set of ones for EU.
No, normally Google operates for international services out of Ireland, and then they have a separate service for the US. So Indian people that use Google would normally be covered by Irish law. And it also turns out that the European data protection rules, the way that we've structured our EP laws, are the international norm. So I think Google was kind of counterproductively making a lot of noise about the right to be forgotten, because it was already in the law at the time when they were, you know, convicted by the European Court of Justice. And we have the new data protection laws in place now, but they haven't entered into effect. And I would argue that the proposal from 2012, which is now law and is about to enter into effect, it will have a more clear procedure for the right to women, which will also help us to make the right balance between freedom of speech and when should stuff be removed. Because I think personally, at least, and I know that in some countries this has caused problems with, you know, public accountability of politicians and so forth, but I think that there is a sense in allowing people to move on from past mistakes. That there are many things that we do in our lives that we don't want to be continuously convicted for, you know, our entire lives. And so the principle behind it is good. You can screw up, we can forget, and then you move on and you can renew yourself. There's no reason for you to be held to account because you were once bankrupt in 1987, or because once you smoked hashish in 1991, or, you know, even in 2005, or once at university you were very drunk. This should not stop you from fully enjoying the opportunities that life could bring you, and that's what we're trying to do in this
moment. So, any truth in Asia is a future where people change their names so that they can be part of so that people think about the history that people change their names.
You can't do that anymore. You can search for images now.
So, but this is also not a bad idea, right? Like, so if you look at whatever Australia, which was a place where people came because they were convicted of crimes, and then they were able to bring this country, which we now all enjoy because of their football and beer. That's not a bad thing. Crocodile Dundee, you know? And being able to move on from your past mistakes, even when your mistakes were quite egregious, it's not a bad thing per se.
So
this is my
somebody who's convicted of domestic violence, and then they want their history to be erased. And, you know, if I'm going to deny that person, I can't look them up and see that they were once convicted for domestic violence.
So in Europe, you wouldn't be able to do that anyway. But normally, the right way to go there is like if you're a girl and you're together with a guy who beats you, beat.
No, but the thing is,
the forgetting threshold will be different for different things.
Okay. No, so suppose I want my history as a domestic, you know, as a perpetrator of domestic violence to be erased, then, you know, that's also problematic, right? Because then nobody has access to that information and they can't judge me on the basis of that information.
Yeah, if you're being convicted for it,
so
then you're serving your time.
So somebody who kills a child, you can't keep punishing them.
Perpetually.
No, the thing is basically something like that should be in the official record.
But
right? There is
or,
a judicial
like
system through
some
which.
Some way that people should know that you have this history.
So there are two
right.
Very different things. Being
bankrupt
and
like
what is the
say,
button
they
yeah.
In all spheres. So you have a reset button for it.
Can be for.
There's
also.
So
you can check the court record.
Being bankrupt is very different from building a domestic.
So you can in the court record, if there's a Indian judge called Indian carbon law, so it keeps record of every case fought in the court. There was this guy who lost a job because his employer googled his name and his name came up in those court records. However, the court pronounced him innocent. But because he was in the court records, he was he could not get a job. So in fact, there was a case, I don't know if somebody asked the Indian Canon Law to, you know, remove their case.
So there is a procedure for getting the court record sealed and basically whether they are open or not. So the sealed records shouldn't end up on that.
I think that's really the US, India is ending this particular case.
So, I mean, these are, and I understand, like intensely moral issues.
Exactly.
And there are some legitimate cases for being able to look at people's background history. My personal opinion, this is only like my personal opinion of what I think should be the case, and other people are very free to disagree, or free to disagree with me if they want to, is if you've been convicted and if you've served your time, then you have already served your dues to the society. This is what society has decided democratically that you should serve. If society was interested in giving you a lifetime punishment, they can send you to jail for life. If they say that you're no longer worthy of having a normal life, we have the death penalty in the worst of all cases. In Europe, we don't, but we could reintroduce it, let's say. But now we have determined that mostly we want for sentences to be, you know, time constrained, and then after you come out, you have the chance to prove that you become a better person. And this is what the right to be forgotten is. And I know in different jurisdictions, they think about this differently. In different jurisdictions, you also think about court records differently. So in Germany, if you ask for a court record, you will not get the names of the people that were in the case. You will have to go to their legal counsel and ask. So so that the verdict is kind of public, but you will only get, you know, initials or even blanks or even no information on what's involved at all. In Sweden, you normally get all the witnesses or perpetrators, the victim of the crime, all of their names are published. My personal feeling is that in Sweden we're a bit too transparent. We're needlessly re-victimizing people who've been victims of crimes, and also we're making it impossible for people, even though they're convicted of very trivial crimes, to move on and have a new life. But much can be said about that, and the right to be forgotten, certainly a lot of these things were discussed. I don't think the right to be forgotten as is implemented in the data protection regulation would be particularly extreme. The European legislature is very cautious about these things. And the way that it's been implemented in European courts up until now is mostly, you know, Spanish and Italian people not wanting to be held accountable for smoking weed in the US. So, and I think that's reasonable. If you know, if you've moved on, if you no longer smoke, if that's not how you want to present yourself to the world, why not? If now you only drink red wine, I'm fine with that. I don't think Google should, or, you know, a place or some other public record should tell anyone any different. Right. So this is also the core principle of the data protection law. Internet blocking and filtering, of course, in the European Union is much different from in India because our governments normally don't shut internet down. But they still do internet blocking and filtering, and this has now become such a big problem that the Council of Europe, which is our kind of regional human rights organization, has decided to make it a priority to make all governments have predictable systems for this in the next 3 years. Because Sweden is one of the countries that doesn't have laws around when the government is allowed to request content from the internet to be taken down. I'm following this with great interest because the Swedish government should really introduce kind of some procedures for this so that it's foreseeable when the government considers information unlawful.
I'm just curious that Google and other companies publish, like in the US they are called NSLs, National Security Letters, like how many requests for takedown and for takedown were received.
That would be different for member state. So in Germany, I don't think the government could be allowed to make that secret, normally. There is a super cool case in Germany now, actually, with D6. It's an internet exchange in Frankfurt.
Is that the German intelligence?
No. D6 is a German internet exchange. And they filed a lawsuit against the German government on wiretapping of internet exchanges in September of this year, which I think is super cool, and I'm following this interest case with interest. So in Germany, they like procedures. If you've worked or met German people, you will know that they like to stick to the rules, and they like to have rules in place. And there's a big point in that, actually, that it makes their society and their government authorities predictable. That whenever they violate you, it's foreseeable for you, which is a good thing. In France, I could imagine it being different. The UK, clearly, with TCHQ and all, they're very secretive about stuff like the NSLs. Sweden would also be more like the UK. But it would be impossible. Yeah, so it would be impossible to generalize in Europe, but normally, maybe in Europe, not as bad as in India. The governments in Europe that are on a similar level of like corruption as India are so small that they couldn't make the same amount of, you know, harmful impact on companies. And so India has the disadvantage of being simultaneously huge and kind of administratively sometimes a bit unstable. But I'm sure you'll work it out over time. You're doing a good job. Things are improving.
So when things have to be blocked over here, is it both mandated or is it an executive mandate? So for example, they have to block access to the website. Will I go to the court and ask authorization? Or will I first block it and then wait for the QR code, wait for the internet, the website to go to the court and challenge my action?
The European Union has 28 member states, and all of them have different rules and also for different types of content. So in Sweden, if it concerns pictures of children who have been exposed to sexual violence, then normally the police, without a court order, can make the decision that a particular piece of material or photographic content should be blocked. There is no appeals procedure, there is no transparency on the list, and ISPs have to use the list. Well, they don't have to, but they do, if they have more than 10,000 customers. For copyrighted content, the issue is still not settled in Swedish law. There's a court case going on. We believe that the court case will not be settled until the European Court of Justice, in the Dutch case, arbitrates whether, in fact, blocking of copyrighted content is mandatory under European copyright law. But even in that case, you would probably have to go to court for copyrighted content afterwards. There wouldn't be like a government dispute. In France, they have a public authority that, without court procedures, decides if copyrighted content is going to be blocked. And it's a huge mess, and especially for big actors like Google, or now increasingly Deutsche Telekom and big telcos. This is a very unpredictable legal situation that we don't like. And so the European Union sometimes tries to harmonize this, but then it turns out it's very difficult and they give up. There's an excellent report on this from the European Commission from 2010, which shows that there's a host of problems all over Europe that the European Commission then kind of buried and never acted upon. We tried to badger the European Commission about this a bit in 2013, but then another commissioner, like not the person responsible for online blocking, but the one responsible for telecommunications, decided to launch a super large and very insane proposal of net neutrality that wasn't good at all. And so everyone was kept busy with that, instead of ensuring that we had foreseeable rules for internet blocking. So it was one of my last struggles in the European Parliament, which I lost, sadly. We could have had predictability and foreseeability in the law, and instead we got whatever the regulation or open internet connections are. And everyone called victory also net neutrality in Europe, which was the case just recently, 2 weeks ago, with the Swedish telecommunications regulator, the Swedish trial equivalent, where it's very clear that it's we don't really have net neutrality in the way that we think about with, say, India, with the current trial regulations on price discrimination. We have some weird technical regulations that I think are in principle to be very useful for people. It's an ongoing struggle. Had I been re-elected, there would have been a lot of work, surely. But there's also a lot of work to be done outside of the legislative institutions. So this covers all of my slides. If you have any other questions that you feel like asking me, you're very welcome to ask me questions. Some of you will already know that I'm on Twitter, where you can also contact me whenever you want, because you have interesting information about India that you feel I need to know. You can contact me over email. You can visit my website. It's all in Swedish. But I produce a large amount of high-quality Swedish content. So if you learn Swedish, Google it will be very useful for you. Mostly it's covered in PDFs. So I transmit it to the government. It's my new, they call it theory of change in the non-governmental organization world of the CIS. Because the Ministry of Justice is all lawyers. I think that lawyers like to read long documents with lots of footnotes. So I'm making lots of PDFs that are long and have lots of footnotes in the hopes that lawyers at the Ministry of Justice will read them and go, oh, this is very sensible and well-sourced. which I think it is. It's not just arbitrary. I do make an effort, I will say. So those are the ways that you... Yeah, I'm also on Facebook. There's lots of ways. Otherwise, I would like to, if nobody else has any quick questions that they would like to raise immediately.
Just a very basic one, because it came up a couple of times, so I'm not sure any legislation which is passed by the European Parliament, how does it sit with the individual members' own, so like what is the relationship? Is it overrided or?
Like EU-wide things versus country?
Yeah. So, I think, so for example, if you pass a legislation regarding...
Yes, that's an interesting question. So, formally, European law does not override member state law necessarily. But the European Court of Justice says that it does, and the member states mostly play law. No, on human rights, that's not in other rights. Or, like, you know. So we have, in the European Union after the Second World War, we also have the European Convention of Human Rights, which is run by the Council of Europe, which is a different organization. And that theoretically overrides member state laws. But in practice, you know, governments are sovereign, and if they don't want to get fucked, they don't get fucked. And this is increasingly a problem in the European Union, that whenever these courts of human rights, or even the European Court of Justice, are making human rights-related just judgments, member states pretend as if they're not there. And it's even at the point where in France, for more than a year, they've been in a state of exception where all of the human rights don't apply except the right to life. And in the UK, they're planning to make a law which exempts troops from human rights obligations, because I can't remember the Theresa May quote now, but I can paraphrase it, perhaps it's like a chokehold on the troops and their activities that they have to respect the human dignity of others. And so they want to exempt. So the human rights situation in Europe at this time isn't terribly good. We lack completely moral leadership. The European Commission is not really able to stand up for that. And certainly the easiest example of this is data retention laws in Europe. But if the European Court of Justice makes a ruling on data retention, so the mandatory kind of collections of large sets of data on all individuals using telecommunications, you have the same kind of rules in India. And the Court of Justice made a ruling that anyone who's sensible and kind of literate that reads this would say, the Court of Justice does not approve of data retention. And still the member states consistently interpret this as, yeah, but actually the court left a loophole here. We can look very carefully in the last paragraph, last sentence of paragraph 67, you'll see that the court is not making a cumulative list of demands. They're making separate requirements that each can be fulfilled or not. And therefore, we can still continue to do data retention, even though most of our citizens will believe that it's not their human rights not to have their data retained. And this is a huge problem because it creates a discrepancy between what citizens deem